Hi everyone, I'm Anne-Marie from Brambleberry.com, and today I'm going to do an important safety video on lye safety. If you've been wanting to make cold process soap for a while and you've been feeling a little intimidated about how to work with sodium hydroxide or lye, this is the video for you. So what is lye and why is it necessary in soap making? So lye is an inorganic compound. It's highly caustic. The pH of lye is actually incredibly high. It's used in water treatment plants, it's used in drain cleaners, and it's even used in bagel making. In soap making, it's used to saponify. That's the technical chemical term that means to turn oils into soap. It's used to saponify the oils to turn them into something new, AKA a beautiful bar of soap. Lye comes in a variety of forms. It can come in pellets, it can come in powder, and it can come in flake form. At Brambleberry, we use the flake form because it has less static cling and it's easier to measure out. Once you've made your soap and you've gotten the oils and the lye to mix, it does take an additional 4 to 6 weeks to ensure that there is no lye present in the final bar. After a couple days, your soap is hard enough to use, and so you might be tempted to use it. If you do, it's still soap. It won't burn you at all, but it does take that additional 4 to 6 weeks to ensure that the pH comes down to levels that are gentle for every single person's skin. So, most common question you see in soap making is, do I have to use lye? Is there an alternative to lye? And then the answer is, if you want to make soap from scratch, there is no alternative to using lye. But if you don't want to ever touch the stuff, say you have little kids at home or a really small workspace and you're just kind of worried about it, you can always do rebatch soap or melt and pour soap. Those are soap bases that are already fully saponified, so they don't need any additional lye. But if you want to choose your ingredients, you want to make your soap from scratch, you will need to use sodium hydroxide. But just like driving a car, lye is safe to use once you know the rules. And what are the safety rules when it comes to working with sodium hydroxide? Well, appropriate safety gear includes long sleeves, long pants, closed-toed shoes, goggles. Goggles are so important because you need to protect your eyes. You only get one set of eyes in a lifetime. And if you're thinking, well, I wear glasses, that's enough. It's not enough, actually. You have to wear goggles over your glasses. Brambleberry.com does sell goggles you can put over your glasses. And finally, you want gloves on to protect your delicate hands from any sort of lye burns. Ventilation is another important component of making soap. Because this gets really hot once you add your lye and water together, it steams up and that can really irritate mucous membranes or even get into your lungs and irritate that. So some soap makers use a respirator or a mask or just have a really nice ventilated cross breeze or even mix their lye water outside. Finally, an interruption-free area is important for making your soap. That means no kids, that means no pets, and that means that you do have that solid 45 minutes to make your soap batch and clean up that fresh raw soap. Once you have your soap making tools identified, make sure they're only used for soap making. That means you don't use what you use for soap making for food. You just never want any accidents to happen. The containers you choose to mix your soap and your fresh lye water in are also really important. So what's a safe container? Well, it's a heat safe container. So you could use heat safe glass, you could use heat safe plastic, and you could use stainless steel. What you never, ever, ever, ever want to do is tin or aluminum because those react with the sodium hydroxide and cause toxic gases. If you're at all concerned about your glass potentially breaking, because I have seen some rumors of that online, and we've never personally had it at Brambleberry in 20 years of using really sturdy Pyrex dishes, you can also mix your lye water over a sink or just choose an alternative form to mix with. Again, the heat-safe plastic or the heat-safe stainless steel. The same rules apply for when you're stirring your lye water and stirring your soap. You want a non-reactive metal, meaning you don't want to use aluminum, you don't want to use tin. You can use silicone, you don't want to use wood because that eventually degrades and then the splinters get in the soap. But you can use silicone, stainless steel, any sort of chemical resistant plastic or heat resistant plastic. And again, once you use it for your soap making, it is for your soap making and you don't want to use it for your food. When using lye or sodium hydroxide, you want to use very precise measurements. Now, every single recipe at brambleberry.com comes with precise measurements on how much lye to use to saponify the amount of oil you're using. If you're on the In the Studio page or buying one of the brambleberry.com kits, they all tell you exactly how much to use. But if you're ready to venture out and create your own recipes, one, good for you, that's awesome, and two, brambleberry.com has an awesome lye calculator that you can use to calculate the correct amount of lye to use for the amount of oils and the type of oils that you wish to make your recipe with. So, you have your safety gear on. You are ready to go. And there's no kids and there's no pets. What do you do next? Big, big, big thing to remember is you always add your lye to your water. You never add your water to your lye. And that includes if you're soaping with an alternative liquid, like say milk. So you always wanna make sure you're adding your lye to your liquid. Otherwise, you could have literally an actual explosion when a large amount of liquid reaches a large amount of lye at the bottom of your container, the whole thing can just explode out and really cause a lot of damage. So be thinking about that. Second, you always want to measure your lye in a separate container from your liquids. This gives you the chance to make sure you're not accidentally adding too much lye into your liquids, but it also gives you a secondary safety measure so you can measure again once you're pouring your lye into your liquids. And finally, make sure you have enough headspace in whatever container you are mixing so there's no spills over or anything like that. So, another thing to think about is where are you gonna store your lye, right? You wanna keep it away from your kids. And any lye you have should always be in, of course, something that is chemical resistant and has a tamper-proof top. Our Brambleberry sodium hydroxide has clearly marked that it is poison, and then we also have keep out of reach of children. You want to store it in a cool, dry environment. It lasts for about a year. Lye actually draws water to itself. And so that means if it sits out in the open air for too long, it will actually get heavier as the water molecules attach to the lye. So you always want to keep it in an airtight container and again, use it up within about a year. And once you have mixed your lye and your lye water and it's cooled down, you know what it looks like? This is actually mixed lye water. It looks just like water. So make sure that you have it clearly labeled that it is lye, toxic, poison. We like to put ours actually in the middle of the counter just in case there's any lye spills, for example. Now, you shouldn't be having your lye water sit around like this, so keep that in mind. Once you mix your lye water and it comes down to the right temperature, you do want to use it just to prevent any common household accidents. So you have taken all these safety precautions, you have done all the things, you're wearing all your stuff, and oh my goodness, a little bit of lye accidentally got right here, right between your glove and your wrist. What are you gonna do? Well, according to the safety data sheet for sodium hydroxide, you just wash the affected area with water. And they say to wash it for 15 minutes. If you get it in your eyes, now that's a different story. You do want to make sure you take out any contacts, and then you want to wash your eyes for a solid 15 minutes with water, and that's like a literal solid 15 minutes, and then go seek medical attention. I've been soaping for, oh gosh, 30 years now. Knock on wood, never happened to me. Appropriate safety measures will make sure it doesn't happen to you. That said, if you are a soap maker and you're doing it routinely, a simple eye washing station, just a single use one, costs between $30 to $50 at most hardware stores. Grab yourself one of those just for peace of mind. So I just mentioned a lye burn and you're like, wait, what? What's a lye burn? It just is a way to refer to if you get some raw soap on your hands or some lye water on your hands or any part of your skin, it starts to itch, it gets a little red, it doesn't feel great, you will notice it right away, maybe like a little bit of poison ivy feeling almost. And unlike a very popular movie that showcased, soap and soap making, that is not what a lye burn feels like. Just rinse it off with water and go about your business. So back when I started soap making, there was like one book on soap making in the entire world, Making Soap and Loving It by Ann Branson. And there was really not a lot of information about what to do if your skin came into contact with lye. And so this kind of misconception or myth about putting vinegar on a lye burn was born. Interestingly enough, first of all, that's not what the safety data sheet says to do. They want you to do water, but if you do that, it causes a chemical reaction that causes the skin to heat up even worse and burn you worse. So no vinegar on lye burns, just use water like the safety data sheet suggests. So how do you clean up soap when you're done with it? Well, at Brambleberry, we just wipe out the excess soap, if there is any, because we try and use it all, of course, with a paper towel, toss that away, and then we use like an aggressive grease cutting soap and really hot water to hand wash our dishes right away. If you turn the soap, you let the soap sit in there and saponify and turn into soap, you can also wash it that way. It does produce a lot more suds. And you might be tempted to stick it in the dishwasher. Do not do that. You can get it really, really, really clean and then give it a final rinse through in the dishwasher. But if you try and actually wash it in the dishwasher, it tends to really suds up and gum up the works. So hand wash those dishes and make sure you're wearing your gloves. I cannot tell you how many experienced soapers will tell you, "Ugh, I did get a lye burn once because I wasn't wearing my gloves when I washed my dishes." So one very final thing. So sodium hydroxide, once mixed with water, has a very high pH. If you spill it onto a wooden countertop, it will discolor the wood forever. So make sure if you're soaping on a delicate surface or something that is permeable, that you actually lay down like chopped up boxes or newspapers in case there's any lye spills. This is a really impervious surface. It'll take a beating. So we don't have to put anything down here, but if you are soaping in a dual purpose area that you don't have just dedicated to soap, make sure you protect your countertops. So if you've watched all the way to the end, I feel really confident that you are a lot more confident in how to make your first batch of soap safely using sodium hydroxide. I'd love to see that first batch of soap. Hashtag it BrambleOn on all the different social media channels, and make sure you hit the thumbs up button below, subscribe to this channel so you're notified each and every time we come out with a video. Until next time, happy soaping. Come at me, soapers. Toxic gases are bad.